Hi, it's me, Tim Dodd, the Everyday Astronaut. Welcome to part two of A Beginner's Guide to SpaceX's webcasts. In part one, we covered everything you need to know leading up to the launch, including what rockets you'll see SpaceX launch, where they launch from, and where they land. Now, in this episode, we're going to explain the difference between reusable, reflown, and expendable first stages. Then, we're going to break down everything you see on screen during the live streams right up to the launch and go over all the callouts you might hear on the radio. Let's get started.
3, 2, 1, 0, 7, 6, 5, 4, 3, 2, 1.
Remember, if you haven't seen part one, be sure and watch that first to help lay down the groundwork for this episode. As of the recording of this video, SpaceX has landed 20 first stages. To date, they've managed to refly 3 of those landed cores, but by the end of the year, if you include the 2 previously flown side boosters of the Falcon Heavy, if it flies this year, they might manage to refly 4 more first stage cores. That being said, sometimes you'll see SpaceX won't even try to land the first stages, meaning the core is expendable. So let's take a quick minute to show you how to spot the differences. The easiest way to know if a core is reusable, reflown, or expendable is to read the description below the SpaceX livestream. But say it's a few weeks ahead of the launch, I suggest checking the sidebar of the SpaceX subreddit. They put a recycled symbol next to the mission name if the stage is reflown. And perhaps maybe we could talk them into putting a trash bin next to cores that will be expendable. At this point, the majority of cores are brand new. This is subject to change though, as we see reuse happening more and more. The easiest way to spot whether or not this brand new core is reusable or not is by looking for the recovery hardware, aka the landing legs, the grid fins, and the nitrogen thrusters. The Falcon 9 requires all 3 of these things to land itself. If you want to know more about how they land, make sure and check out my video titled How SpaceX Lands Using Grid Fins, Thrusters, and Engines. So how can you tell if a core has already launched, landed, and is now reflying again? Well, if you're very keen-eyed, you might actually be able to spot if the booster is reflown by the wear of the paint on the first stage. Take a look at this close-up of a picture I took of the first reflown booster for mission SES-10, which flew earlier this year. And now expendable. Ugh, yuck. You'll know an expendable Falcon 9 when you see one. Trust me, they look completely naked. They're absent of landing legs, grid fins, and nitrogen thrusters. These days, they look downright wrong. If you're wondering why they'd even do an expendable launch these days, you should check out my video titled Why SpaceX Lands on Land Sometimes and on the Drone Ship Other Times. But long story short, depending on how heavy the payload is and where it's heading to in space, there just might not be enough margin to land the booster. So it goes into the drink like basically every rocket before it. So now on to the live streams. Let's talk about what you're going to see on screen leading up to T-0. Well, first off, let's check out that progress bar. Tune into this to know what events are coming up. SpaceX used to put several events leading up to liftoff, but as of March 2017, they tend to only put up the word startup before liftoff. We'll get more into that in a minute. At the top left corner of the progress bar, you'll see the word launch followed by the mission name. This usually is just the name of the customer of the payload or the name of the specific satellite they're launching into space. Now remember, SpaceX is basically the delivery service for a payload. Think of their rockets as semi-trucks hauling a payload to a certain destination. A customer pays SpaceX or any other launch provider a good chunk of money to get their spacecraft into space. Now don't be confused, but one of SpaceX's biggest customers is NASA. NASA currently purchases commercial resupply services for the International Space Station from SpaceX, Orbital ATK, and soon from Sierra Nevada. So if you ever see a SpaceX mission that says CRS and a number, that means it's a commercial resupply service heading to the International Space Station, and the customer is NASA. Those are extra high-profile missions with NASA live streaming and supporting the mission. NASA has also awarded contracts for the commercial crew services, which means both SpaceX and Boeing will be flying astronauts to the International Space Station starting sometime in 2018. These missions will be called CCP, for Commercial Crew Program, and we'll see SpaceX using their Dragon 2 capsule to carry astronauts launched on top of their Falcon 9, which isn't too different from SpaceX's current cargo capsule, the Dragon 1. For more info about the Dragon capsule, check out my video titled Why SpaceX Won't Propulsively Land the Dragon Capsule, which goes into the history and the future of the Dragon spacecraft. Other than NASA, some of SpaceX's most common customers include private companies, such as SES, Iridium, TICOM, or AsiaSat. But you might also see government customers such as the United States Air Force, the National Reconnaissance Office, or NRO, and the National Oceanic and Atmospheric Administration, or NOAA. Let's go into perhaps the most obvious thing on screen, the countdown clock. Simply put, when this baby hits zero, the rocket takes off, hopefully. But there's a catch. Missions actually have a launch window of time when they can launch, and some are much shorter than others. Due to the alignments of different orbits and when rendezvousing with spacecraft such as the International Space Station, there often is what's known as an instantaneous launch window. This means there's only 1 second when the launch pad actually lines up with the orbit due to the Earth's spin. So all SpaceX CRS and CCP missions are instantaneous for this reason. You might actually see the countdown clock stop and then reset or move entirely while waiting for the weather to improve or other variables. However, since SpaceX uses super chilled propellants and oxygen, they often only get one chance to fuel up and attempt to launch due to the launch window being shorter than the amount of time it takes to reset and refuel the vehicle. So if the clock resets, most of the time it's done for the day and they'll have to try again for another day. Listen to the webcast host who will often tell you how long their launch window is and if there's a chance to reset. There's millions of variables at play that all need to be acceptable before they commit to launching. If you ever hear hold, hold, hold called out over the radio, it means the launch is scrubbed for the day due to something that is outside of acceptable conditions.
Hold, hold, hold. Launch support is started.
There's a whole long list of pre-flight checks that SpaceX runs leading up to liftoff. But there's a few we might actually hear them talk about over the radio leading up to T-minus zero. Let's check those out. Although this happens before the webcast starts at about just T-minus 1 hour, there's a launch readiness poll conducted by the flight director. You'll often hear the launch readiness poll called the go, no-go poll. This is just like what you see in the movies when the flight director asks each station if they're go for launch.
Give me a go, no-go for launch. Booster.
Go.
Retro.
Go.
Vital.
We're go fly.
Guidance,
go.
At T-minus 1 hour, the Falcon 9 starts loading up its RP-1 fuel. RP-1 is a very high-grade kerosene fuel, even more highly refined than jet fuel. At T-minus 35 minutes, the Falcon 9 starts loading up its liquid oxygen. Since rocket engines aren't air-breathing engines, they actually carry their own oxidizer, or in this case, liquid oxygen, on board. This allows the rockets to work in the vacuum of space. Around the T-minus 30 minute mark, there's a range readiness check to make sure there are no aircraft or boats along the path of the rocket along the predetermined exclusion zone. The Air Force actually publishes the launch hazard areas before every launch. This is something that local shipping companies, fishermen, cruise ships, and airliners are very aware of. Everyone's expected to be up to date with the hazard times and areas so they don't cause the scrub of a launch. Don't forget, there's hundreds of people on the clock as well as expensive rocket fuel that gets wasted with every restart. Therefore, there's heavy fines if someone violates those exclusion zones. The following callouts you might actually hear live on a webcast, so let's focus on a few of those callouts. At T-minus 4 minutes or so, you'll see the strongback retract to about 1.5 degrees. The strongback is that big white thing that takes the Falcon 9 out of the hangar and stands it upright, and it also provides all the support and the connections to the rocket. You'll see their new strongback at 39A actually falls back 45 degrees rather quickly at T-minus zero. But if the launch is out of Vandenberg, you'll notice they still use the old design strongback, which retracts to about 77.5 degrees and stays there at T-minus 3 minutes and 30 seconds. This means it receives a larger and more direct blast from the rocket as it takes off, which leads to more refurbishment after every launch. The new strongback allows for a much quicker post-flight refurbishment and reduces the time needed to prepare the launch pad for the next flight. SpaceX will probably start using this new design on all their pads, so keep a keen eye to those subtle differences. Around the T-minus 3 minute mark, we hear AFTS armed and ready for launch. This is the autonomous flight termination system, which is what would destroy the rocket if it goes straying off course. SpaceX was the first company to utilize the NASA-developed autonomous version, which doesn't require ground personnel to terminate the rocket. At T-minus 2 minutes and 55 seconds, we hear Verify Good MVAC TVC, which means that they verify that the single Merlin vacuum engine in the second stage has good thrust vector control. TVC is what steers the second stage, and that's something that's rather important. At T-minus 2 minutes and 45 seconds, they call stage 1 locks closeout, meaning the liquid oxygen is fully loaded in the first stage. At T-minus 2 minutes, we hear stage 2 locks closeout, which means the liquid oxygen is fully loaded in the second stage. At T-minus 1 minute and 55 seconds, we hear the Falcon 9 is on internal power, meaning its power is now coming from internal batteries and not from ground support equipment. At T-minus 1 minute and 30 seconds, we hear the vehicle is in self-align, which means the vehicle double-checks its proper alignment of its internal gyroscopes and accelerometers. At T-minus 1 minute and 20 seconds, we hear they have completed loading the super cold cryogenic helium, which maintains tank pressure as the vehicle consumes fuel and oxidizer. It's important to maintain pressure in the fuel and oxidizer tanks so the engine's turbo pumps don't ingest air bubbles. Air bubbles can cause what's known as cavitation, a small but powerful wave that can erode metal from the fuel pump. If those bits of metal get into the engine, it's a very bad thing. T-minus 1 minute and 15 seconds, we hear TTEB setup complete. TTEB stands for triethyl aluminum, triethyl borane, which is pyrophoric, meaning it ignites on contact with oxygen. either in the air or liquid oxygen in the rocket. This ignites without the presence of a spark, and this is what SpaceX uses to light their Merlin engines. Look for that signature green flash at T-minus 3 seconds. At T-minus 1 minute, we hear AFTS is ready for launch, which means that autonomous flight termination system is verified and ready for launch. Also around the T-minus 1 minute mark, we'll hear verify Falcon 9's in startup and gas closeout is complete. The Falcon 9 startup process is 100% internal. This means the rocket itself is in control of the remaining countdown procedure and prepares itself for that final minute leading up to launch. Liquid oxygen is now flowing through the first stage Merlin engines as they prepare for ignition at T-minus 3 seconds. T-minus 45 seconds, stage 1, stage 2, pressurized for flight. They just double check that the tanks are fully loaded and pressurized for flight. At T-minus 40 seconds, the launch director is asked to verify their go for launch, to which they'll confirm or call a hold if anything seems off nominal. At T-minus 15 seconds, they confirm the Falcon 9 is configured for flight. At T-minus 10 seconds, we'll see something that's super awesome that I want to get more into at a later time. This is when they turn on the water deluge system, which helps suppress sound and absorb energy so the rocket doesn't tear itself and the launch pad apart. Have you ever noticed that giant water tower on site? That's not there in case of a fire. T-minus 5 seconds, and we'll see the telemetry pop up on the screen. This will show us the real-time velocity and altitude of the vehicle. At T-minus 3 seconds, we might actually catch that greenish flash at the bottom of the rocket as they begin igniting all 9 Merlin engines with that T-tab. And finally, at T-minus 0, after the rocket confirms all engines are lit and healthy, the clamps that hold onto the rocket let go, the strongback falls back to 45 degrees, and voila, the 7,600 kilonewtons of thrust overcomes the force of gravity and lift that 70 meter or 230 foot tall beauty of modern engineering into the sky. Now, before we wrap up for today, let's take just a quick second to pause and reflect on how incredible this moment really is. The moment when a machine whose skin is so thin it can be crushed like a soda can. A machine that breathes fuel so cold it's almost a solid. A machine with enough raw explosive power to level a small town all comes together to work in perfect harmony. The scale of this endeavor always takes me back a step. Next time you drive by a water tower, just imagine something almost twice as tall suddenly rising from the ground under a column of its own flame and lifting off into the cosmos. It honestly gets me every single time. Looks like we're gonna have to pick up the rest in the next episode. In part 3, we're going to talk about what happens when the clock goes positive and the rocket begins to take flight. So let me know if you have any questions about this video or if there's anything that needs to be included in this next video in the comments below. That being said, make sure you subscribe so you can join the discussion when we continue to learn more about SpaceX, NASA, and all things spaceflight. Also, remember I live host SpaceX launches starting about 30 minutes or so before liftoff, so come ask questions and join the conversation live. A big, huge, and sincere thank you to my Patreon supporters for helping make this and other Everyday Astronaut content possible. I owe a special thanks for those of you patrons in our exclusive Discord channel who helped me script and research. If you want to help contribute or share your thoughts and input on upcoming videos, please visit patreon.com/everydayastronaut. Thank you. Don't forget to check out my web store for shirts, hats, and prints of rocket launches and original artwork, mugs, and lots of other fun stuff at everydayastronaut.com/shop. You can add it to your holiday wish list. And as always, all the music in my videos is original. Feel free to check it out and download it for free at soundcloud.com/everydayastronaut. Tell a friend. Thanks everybody, that does it for me. I'm Tim Dodd, the Everyday Astronaut, bringing space down to Earth for everyday people.